can certainly be a little bit overwhelming, the amount of little tasks you have to complete. And on a wet day like today, I just come in, I've got no motivation. The key is just to do something. It doesn't matter what you do. So what I've actually done today is on our fridge cabinet here, I've gotten in and I've really detailed the edges and rounded everything off. This is gonna have to be flow coated and sprayed. So what it'll end up looking like is a cabinet, a bit like the picture over there, and I'll show you that picture of what this is supposed to look like. But I've actually raised it up because we have a higher fridge. Our fridge is a Vitrafrigo two door, and it's going to come into around about here. So I've just glued this section in here, but before I go home, I'm gonna tab all the way around the edges here. At the moment, it's only foam. It's pre-laminated foam core, and it's glued together with epoxy. But to get a nice uniform finish, I do need to put some finishing cloth on it just to get that a couple of layers over the top there, and then I'll be able to get in and fair it correctly and spray it. Now, there's lots of fine edges and stuff, and basically, Janet last week was able to laminate this. Now, this is a little bit rough, and it's going to need a little bit more work all the way from there, all the way along here, down and around the floor. But for now, I'll just get this finishing cloth on. Probably gonna take me 10 minutes to do the whole thing. It's pretty quick to laminate, and it will get the job a long way forward, because once I cut the hole there for the fridge, essentially that's going to mean that I can just spray this out and then insert the fridge, and that whole module's complete, and then I can move on to doing the top here. It will have a Corian top on the top here. I think the minimum you can buy is about 8 mil, but I'm gonna try to get it a little bit lighter. I'm not that worried about weight, to be honest, on a boat of this size. I'm starting to sort of neglect the weight a little bit because I just want the thing finished, and I'm not that worried about it being a performance cat, because it's not. I know that, I've said that a million times. You can see the sort of finish we get here, how smooth that is. It's not raised, there's no massive boys, because it's such a fine cloth. It's about 100 grams a square meter, this stuff, so it's absolutely superb for getting a nice finish, just to get to that last fairing level, as opposed to this, which is peel ply, which is pretty smooth, probably a touch smoother than this, but you know, waste peel ply, it also is a very good way of finishing off. And you know, if I want to make it resin rich, I can, but I don't really want to at this stage. I just want to get the edges protected and that foam protected, so that when I come back with my fairing compound, I've got no massive voids to fill, and that actually keeps weight out of the boat in turn, rather than laminating with like 400, 600 double bias or quadraxials where there's a lot of air. This stuff, this aerolite, is very, very fine and does not create a lot of filler. Fairing compound is the most expensive way to fill holes. If you can fill holes with the resin you're already applying, then you're better off to do that. You don't want to be putting in too much fairing compound, because it's a huge waste of money. All you're going to do is sand it out. What do you reckon, mate? Do you go home? Had enough? Lunchtime. Yeah, I'll take you home and then I'll come back without you. Righto, so that is now done. Fully laminated. Two layers of finishing cloth on all the corners. Oh, I got a bit of a bubble there. Wouldn't that shit you? Right, I better roll that out. One thing I've learned about laminating, never walk away until you check it. I've got a couple little issues here. Little bubble here. Always worth having one final little walk over before you walk away from it. And that's looking pretty good.
So this may look like a small canoe, but it's actually called a nacelle mold. And I'm polishing it up so that we can make effectively wave breakers that go under the hard deck at the front. And what they do is they act as a disperser of the waves, so that the waves don't slam on the bottom of the deck. Because we're solid, we have a solid deck, we need that to break away the force of the wave so it's not too noisy. We're going to put two underneath the deck. We may put one, but I think we're going to make two. But I'm going to polish it up before we can lay it up. First layer is the supercut compound.
I've been pretty busy up on the boat just working away, getting little jobs done. I've got a lot of little things on the go at the moment. I don't seem to be able to get anything major done. The only problem with having an apprentice or having Janet working with me is I generally have to think 1 or 2 days ahead. And when I know she's coming in, I've got to line up some jobs for her. So I've lined up these two jobs. These are two pretty amazing molds. They're very, very different to what we're normally used to doing. And I'll just give you a run through of what they are. They're pretty unusual looking molds. And I've got to be honest, I've put these off for such a long time because there's a little bit of work involved with this one. This small, long, slender mold here is actually a ridge cap mold for the stern of the boat. So it'll basically be a transom mold that'll cover the join between the deck and the hull. Pretty keen to have this because I think it's going to look absolutely fantastic. I was going to do it out of carbon to have this nice black carbon seam along the back of the boat. Having a carbon seam, a pure carbon seam along the back of the boat in the Australian heat could potentially be a disaster. Just they tend to go yellow, particularly because the epoxy that you use here is really not great in the UV. So I don't like having those carbon bling parts on boats. They tend to just dull. You know, it looks great when you first do them. Now, the other thing I have here, you'll notice here, is actually the wave breaker that Janet's been doing. I am going to put at least one of these underneath our bridge deck because we've got a solid bridge deck, and potentially a second one as well, in order to break up the waves that are going to hit underneath the deck. We certainly want to try to reduce slamming in every instance if we can. It'll be a pretty simple layup, but having that under there will actually help to vaporize the waves that will inevitably belt up underneath our bridge deck. And you know, we've got like 1.2 meters of bridge deck clearance. However, we do know that this boat has a little bit of slamming, nowhere near as bad as some bridge deck catamarans, but certainly it could be an issue. So I'm going to put at least one on. I may put the second, but this one either is going to go in the center, or if we make two, I'll put them separated, just like in this photo here of the last power cat they made. Now, it is a bit of a power cat thing having these nacelles up underneath the bridge deck, but I actually think it looks pretty spacey, so I'm going to do it. We're going to make it anyway. It's not a really big deal to make. It's going to be simply a few layers in there, and as the wave comes up underneath it, the idea is that it actually splashes and disperses. So both of these items will get made up tomorrow, and Janet's pretty excited to come in and get them done. So I'm just about ready. I'm just going to give it one last release wax, and then I'm going to come in and spray white gel coat on them and get them ready for lamination. Basically, they're going to be a little bit awkward to laminate, particularly this one. It's not really well supported, and you should always try to support your mold as best as possible. I've made a couple of timber braces here, and I've got a clamp to the work table here so that when I gel coat it, it will hold together. It's a very, very awkward mold, and in fact I think it used to have a pretty substantial brace on here looking at this fiberglass here. But you know, at the end of the day, that'll be enough. It's not like it needs to be super rigid, this thing. It's just basically a dress trim. I haven't worked out the laminate schedule for that. I want to keep it reasonably light because I don't want any excess weight up on the front, but I also need to make sure that it's going to be able to withstand a wave coming up underneath it and really certainly hitting it. We've been in there making the transom trim for the join in the hull and the deck, and I forgot to film. And I said to Janet, "Oh, I've forgotten to film it." It's not often I forget to film, is it? Even though it's a pretty small part, it's 14 foot long, and it's pretty complicated because there's a lot of consolidating needing to be done with the fin roller, getting those air bubbles out. And what I did is I actually put a radius of filler into it, and just to basically stop any chance of any air bubbles. It's going to be a very difficult part to chip repair should we get any air bubbles in it. But yeah, Janet and I have been laying this one up. I was going to leave it to Janet on her own, but here we've already peel plied this section here and we're onto the last layer. So it's looking really good. That's going to be a nice piece of dress trim and finish the edge of the boat off without any issues. It's going to look, I think that's going to look fantastic. It was a bit complicated to build the structure to hold it. And as you can see, we've got a cardboard box underneath it here. Very important to keep it steady while it cures. We don't want any twists in it. But yeah, well done, Jen.
It looks shallow,
man. It won't matter, you've got excess.
Yeah, because that's only 26.
Yeah. But just make it 350 or something.
Well, that's 400. That'll have to be 400.
Yeah. What'd you say?
It's the state of my hair in your face.
Doesn't matter about the state of your hair.
It does.
We're only watching you for your skill.
And there's well, me I'm thinking not. You're watching me for my beauty.
I am watching you for your beauty, honey. I love you. Right, so Janet's laid up. Well, not laid up, but cutting her cloth.
She's got taking forever.
Cloth everywhere, yeah. Preparations,
so these
everything.
Are the 300s.
Yep.
There's one layer of 600 here. I thought I'd do those.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
I've
cool.
I'm going to do two more.
Yeah, two more layers of 600. I might put a little bit of foam in the middle, like a V in the middle.
Every time Ross tells me what he wants me to do this, he changes his mind.
No,
he said, don't put a strip down the middle because you're going to overlap each one, so we don't.
I'm not talking
one.
About a strip. I'm talking about a V of foam. I might just put in it just right. To like a small bulkhead in it, just to stop it from going that.
Oh, like
yeah,
a
that
V
won't
of
affect
cross.
You. Yeah.
I thought just, you meant like put foam on that.
No,
side
I'll just glue it in. But yeah, that's cool. Cool. All right, I'll get back to it.
Okay.
See ya. Now we're going to leave the layup of the nacelles for next week's video as I need to prepare some jobs in advance to keep Janet on the go till the end of the build. The bathroom floor panels were made some 4 years ago and they've been stored for a time right about now and they'll likely require some adjustment and further reinforcement. There's plenty of foam and backfilling to be done, but for now a test fit was in order. Close quarters today, guys. It's 36 degrees outside. Must be at least 45 in here. It's warm, and I'm feeling it today. It's only about 10 o'clock in the morning. We're on for a beast. And, yeah, don't know how long I'll be today, but I've done a fair bit already. I've already sprayed up a sheet of anisole. Righto, the bathroom floor, we're going to have to trim the edges a little bit and sand it down because it is a little bit of a tight fit. I sort of want a tight fit, but the other thing you've got to remember is that the perimeter of this floor is actually the drain. So I do need it to drain away. And it could create a little bit of problem for me a bit later on going forward. But anyway, we'll get it made and then I'll sand the outside edges of it. But as you can see, yeah, it's a perfect fit. The only problem is I want water to drain down the outside, so I think I might be doing a little bit of sanding around the outside once Janet finishes backing it with foam. So yeah, she's a bit of a tight fit, but we'll work on that. All I really needed to know was how it was going to fit around the drain here. We had a good look in this area here yet, other than putting pumps in. This here is a drain. And it comes down to a floor drain here. So this will have like a sink, 50mm drain, stainless steel drain there. So all the water has to go to that spot there. Very, very important that I get water over the side and funneling around to that area. I've got a little bit of tidying up to do there. Yeah, not really sure how I'm gonna action this. Probably have to sand a gel coat off the edge of the floor piece and redo it, get it a little bit thinner. But yeah, I'll get it done. And we've got our bilge pumps down there, they're all working. So luckily I'm really at the point where I'm starting to get to the real nuts and bolts of this boat. And you know, things like this, although they're only really cosmetic and I don't really need them yet, they're stuff that Janet can get on with up in the factory and I can just get on with the more important stuff. This is so important, but not to sort of put down anything Janet's doing for me, but all the stuff she's tending to do is the stuff that's really going to use my time up when I'm trying to get the bulk of the boat work finished. So this great job, and she can go in there in the factory, and she loves being up there because she's not with me and I'm not annoying her all day. So we've got a similar setup down in our starboard head, down at the forward end of the boat here, up on the bow, and right on our ensuite here. You can see here I've made a plywood version of this floor. I'm just going to sit this one in place and see if it fits. I fear this one's going to be a bit tight too. It's absolutely filthy in here, and I'm doing nothing to kill spiders at the moment. They're just everywhere, little mongrels. There's an old saying in Australia, you're only ever 1 metre away from a spider. All right, well, that one's perfect. Right, that looks the business, hey? That is really good. Right, well, that one will be fine. That's going to let plenty of water down. All right, that one's looking pretty good. Now, what Janet's going to do is put 10 mil of foam underneath the bottom of this and then make it solid glass and then leave a lip for the water to run down and into the bilge or into our shower drain. But that's great. That's really good. Perfect. Yeah, what we'll do, we might run a bead of epoxy around the outside, get some weights on that. I'd just whack some weights on it now as it is. So, yesterday afternoon, just about to leave, and I thought, just gonna see how these stanchions fit on the side of the boat for my lifelines. And of course I've got such an extreme curve on the side of the boat, I need to somehow either insert them or build up a platform underneath them, a little plinth for each of them to sit. Now there are 10 stanchions, plus I have all of my handrails and the forward pulpits that I purchased secondhand recently off another boat, which is going to have to be modified to fit. So I've come up with the idea that I'm actually going to cut into the deck and insert them in so that I have good water flow away, but also a good solid base for them to sit. So this is the result. This pad is going to be inserted into a hole that I'm going to cut in the side of the deck, and then because it's solid glass, I'll then glass that up in underneath the boat with solid glass, and that'll give me a solid base for the actual thing to sit. Now it does actually overhang a little bit, so it's going to require a little bit of foam work and a little bit of tidy up around it, but I think that's going to be the best way, because that way I can get these 750 mil high stanchions vertical all the way down the side of the boat. And so I've made 14 of these. I'm going to need at least 12. I've made another two just because I may need them up on the pulpit as well. It looks like it will sit flat, but the other ones are certainly not going to. Now, I've just purchased a tube bender last night, not a pipe bender, but a tube bender to be able to make all of my own handrails. I've decided rather than try to subcontract this thing out and send it out to send templates off, I'm better off to bend them all myself and then try to find a welder, or worst case scenario, I'll do it myself. I'm not really sure I want to do that because I'm not a great welder, but who says I can't learn? And in the process of this whole build, I've tried to do everything myself, including the wiring, the plumbing, the glasswork, and the woodwork. I want to try to do the whole thing myself, and it will obviously save me a lot of money in the long run, but it's going to be a very, very steep learning curve. I do need some lifelines down the side of the boat, and it's a 10-12 foot drop off the side of the boat, and I just simply can't risk that anymore. In fact, I'm stopping people walking down there now. They're not going to be able to go down the side until I get my lifelines in place. Here are all the pieces. They're in varying thicknesses, that's the only issue, and I do have to bevel the edges of them, but they will work. And once I start to laminate them in, I can build them up to around about a centimeter thick, which is going to be more than enough for supporting the stanchions. In fact, it's going to give them a good flat base, and there won't be any wobbling of them, which is really important. I don't want any wear and tear on these bases as the stanchion fits on top of these. I'll show you how they're going to fit in a moment, but for now I've set myself up over here. I'm going to get my flap disc out, try to tidy up the back of them so that they're all pretty much similar, and then getting ready to cut some more holes in the boat. So I spent pretty much a better part of yesterday cutting these holes out of the side of the boat, and yeah, that hurt when you do something like that. But what I've actually done is I've actually sanded all the way around it so that I can fair these positions into place. So this one here is the one that I'm going to use as my demo one, and as you can see, if I sit the stanchion in place, stanchion. It's dead vertical, and it's going to give me a wider companionway. What's always been a bit of a concern for me is the width of the companionway down here. It's not that wide. I have a second one up here, so you step up as you go forward, but this is going to be enabling me to be able to use this companionway entirely. We will have a shroud coming up around here somewhere, which is going to certainly affect our movement going forward. But yeah, that gives me the space to work right out wide, and then I'm going to block fill underneath, re-laminate it, refair it all. So I've done basically all the way along. And then this last one here is actually going to be these pulpits that I've purchased, and I'm going to tidy them up. I've just bought a tube bender. I'll be able to change all that. So you see it from the front. And one of the reasons why I haven't fixed this slot is exactly for that reason, because I knew I had a lot of other work coming up. You can see the result of what I've done. And now why they're poked up through is because I can't reach them from the outside, and they won't fit through the hole from the outside. They have to come in from the inside. So I'm going to glue them in place now with some epoxy, leave them for the day. I'll screw them up in place, make sure they're exactly right. I've already leveled them all out. They do have to face slightly downwards, which is great. Having them face downwards is going to be really good, because what that's going to do is let the water run away. There'll be no water pooling in that area there, and they'll all be rounded and sanded and re-laminated with tons of glass. So everything looks a bit like this from underneath, and I'm just going to take you down to one of the ones in the stern cabin here. What I'm trying to do is get these things looking as flush as possible from the inside as well. Nice thing about what I've actually done here is it's only going to create a small hump here. I'm not going to have a big protrusion into the room here, and obviously we're going to have some sort of a lining over this. But this guy here, if I put through, so the mount actually slides into the slot like that, fits in on that lip there, and it'll be glued to the surface there, and then basically laminated over. So I'll be able to put about probably 5 or 6 good layers of glass over the top of that. It'll only be a minor bump in the whole scheme of things, but it'll give me a really solid base for my stanchion on the other side. And I've got another one here which is actually sitting halfway on a bulkhead, so that's even going to be even stronger. And that's our midpoint one, almost in the midpoint, but that actually will be glued with epoxy all the way around, and then I'm going to basically laminate over the top and laminate it into the bulkhead. Another one here, another one up the front. So I've got 5 of these in total, plus one for a handrail, which I intend to use the exact same base just to keep everything consistent right up here in the bathroom as well. And the head looks pretty drastic, but it's going to look really nice when it's all blocked in from the outside. I'm going to be able to get a nice finish on the outside to make it all look consistent from the side of the boat, but it'll give it a really solid platform. And the other thing is that all the water is going to drain away, and they will be reinforced rather than just bolting straight through the deck of the boat. So it's a good solution. It's taken me a little bit of while to come up with that idea.